Oh, I like it. I enjoy it. I stopped using that greasy kid stuff, too. Just like everybody else did, man.
You used to be criticized so much for your long hair and your racism. You seem so modest now.
Man, I was tame compared to what they do now. Are you kidding? I didn't do anything. We just jiggle, you know. Yeah. Oh, I don't know. I really can't criticize anybody. In the entertainment field, I think there's room for everybody, and I hate to criticize another performer. It's according to what you're talking about. I don't know.
Mr. Presley, on the subject of the service, what is your opinion of war protesters, and would you today refuse to be drafted?
Honey, I just seem to keep my own personal views about that to myself, because I'm just an entertainer, and I'd rather not say.
Do you think other entertainers should keep their views to themselves, too?
No. I can't even say that. Can I talk to my father?
Can we ask him a question?
He handles all my personal affairs.
Can we ask him a question?
Fine.
No. Can we ask your father a question?
Oh, sure.
The other Mr. Presley. At what point did you realize that your son was more than your son and now a very, very famous person?
Well, it's kind of hard to say, you know. It happened so fast, it's hard to keep up with it, you know. It just boom, overnight, and there it was. So I'd say maybe probably 1956, the first television show.
Do you have any regrets that he's become
that big? I tried to tell him sooner, but he wouldn't listen.
No, I have no regrets of it. In fact, I have enjoyed it, really.
All kidding aside, it happened very fast to all of us, my mother and my father and all of us. That, you know, everything happened overnight, and so we had to adjust to a lot of things very quickly. You know. A lot of good things.
Elvis Presley Sr., after Elvis got famous, do you think he changed in any way at all?
No, not really. I can't tell that he changed anything.
Burning love.
There were some truck drivers, believe it or not, that drove big diesel trucks and so forth across country, and they, I don't know, they had scars on them. They were wild looking guys. So I used to lay on the side of the road and watch these guys drive these trucks. And I just, when I was old enough to grow sideburns, I grew them, you know. I got criticized a lot for them, and kicked off the football team and so forth. I suppose so by normal standards, but it was just something I wanted to do. I wasn't trying to be better than anybody else.
Next song. Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. And it's down at the end of a lonely street, a heartbreak hotel. I'm so lonely, baby. Well, I'm so lonely. I'll be so lonely, I could die. Although it's always crowded, you still can find a room for broken-hearted lovers to cry their inner gloom. And be so lonely, baby. Be so lonely, be so lonely, you could die.
Well, it's an old suit, and it had, it's got pleats in it, and so forth, so it had to be like 55 or 56. And the guy in the background is my first drummer, DJ Fontana. That's the same guitar that I use now. Same one. Yeah, well, I have two, you know. I was in a nightclub one night, and this big fight broke out in this club. I had two guitars. I always keep one on the side in case I break the strings. And I remember thinking, I hope that nothing happens to that guitar. It's brand new. I heard a crunch, and this guy had stepped in it. Had it hanging on his foot, man. So, I had to get a new one there. Yeah, I had a lead guitar player, a bass player, not an electric bass, an upright bass, a guy named Bill Black, and the drummer, that was it. Two one-nighters, and I was working in Shreveport, Louisiana. Well, it was good. It was good enough for then, I thought. The guys were good musicians. They were with me from the time I made the first record. They were called in by the guy that I started with, Sam Phillips, on Sun Records. I got caught in some pretty good crowds. We had to learn that over a period of time. I got slept in the back of a car, and, you know, we'd do a show and we'd get off stage and get in a car, drive to the next town, and sometimes we'd get there just in time to the show. Wash up. It was always exciting. As far as the numbers of people, we had to go according to the buildings, you know. And when I first started out, they didn't have the buildings that they have now. You know, like I would play, like the Fox Theater in Detroit. And it didn't hold that many people, so I'd do six or seven shows. They'd show a movie, and I'd come on to a live show. Yeah, I was
kind of people were on the show?
It was mostly people from the Grand Ole Opry at that time. I was an extra added attraction, you know, on the show. The first time it happened, the first time that I appeared on stage at the charity thing, it was a place called The Shell. When I left the stage, you were yelling and screaming and stuff. I did two songs. And it scared me to death, man. I didn't know what I'd done. The manager backstage, I said, "What'd I do? What'd I do?" He said, "Well, whatever it is, go back and do it again." So I went back out and did the same thing again. I really didn't know what the yelling was about. Screaming. I didn't realize that I was moving. My body was moving. It's a natural thing to me. I wasn't aware of it, it was the rhythm. And the guy that played bass for me was he could slap the bass, a double leg, you know. It was really a wild sound, it was like a jungle drums or something. You know. We enjoyed it, you know, we enjoyed it on stage. It was very wild, and we had to. It was in. When I first realized I could sing, at about 2 years of age, I found myself singing. I mean, I was singing, and people would listen to me around the housing project where I lived. As time went by, I was about 8 years old, and they entered me in a talent show. I wore glasses, had no music, and I won, I think it was fifth place in this talent contest, this state talent contest. I got a whipping the same day. My mother whipped me for something. I wanted to ride. Destroyed my ego completely. But I would sing like in church, my mother and father, but you know, when I was about 10 years old, they gave me a choice between a guitar and a bicycle. So I took the guitar and to watch people. I learned to play it a little bit. But I would never sing in public. I was very shy about it. In 11th grade in school, they entered me in another talent show. Nobody even knew I sang anything. I was singing around the apartment building where I lived. Well, I wasn't, like I said, I wasn't popular in school. I wasn't dating anybody at that school. I failed music. I was taking music. I flunked music just flat. Man. F. Only thing I ever failed. And they entered me in this talent show. And I came out. I did my two songs. And when I came on stage, I heard people kind of rumbling and whispering and so forth. Because nobody knew I even sang, really. And it was amazing how popular I became in school after that. let me see. "Till I Waltzed Again With You" by Teresa Brewer. That was a song I sang. So then I went on through high school and I graduated. Well, about the same thing happened later on at the Shell, you know. The kids and everybody really went, you know, I got 10 or 11 encores, that type of thing. They just kind of halted the show at that period. And it scared me, but then it made me very happy too. But I was still shy about it. I wouldn't sing in public for a long time. And I went for maybe a year. I just kind of forgot about it. I got out of school and I was driving a truck. I was dating a girl and waiting for her to get out of school so we could get married. Yeah, I was training to be an electrician's helper, an electrician, because they make $3 an hour. You know, and I was very serious about it. I made that first record really as a personal thing for my mother. And that same company called me a year later. They said, "We got a song that you might be able to do." It was 12 o'clock. They said, "Can you be here by 3 o'clock? I was there by the time they hung up the phone. You know. Anyway, when they found me from the waist up, I think it was a matter of, it was new at that time to see anybody's body vibrate or move at all. You know. And that's what I was doing. I wasn't conscious of those type things. You know. Really, when I saw it, played back, and I was so busy at that time, man, until I didn't really have time to. You gotta remember, you know, I was just 19. Just shoved me out in the world. They treated me very well. I've had people ask me if I had a rough time or something. I just did the same thing everybody else did. I didn't ask for anything, and they didn't give me anything, you know. I just did the same thing everybody else did. And I made it very well. I had no trouble at all. Now, they asked me once or twice, like Bob Hope would come over and do his Christmas thing, you know? Christmas show. And they put a little pressure on me about doing his shows. And I said, "Gentlemen," I said, "I've been in, you know, I don't have any instruments. It'd be difficult for me. I'd have to bring my musicians over here." "I will do that." But I didn't want to do it. I just felt I couldn't really mix the two. I couldn't be in show business and be in the service too. Well, I had the attitude of "screw you," you know. All is fair in love and war, Jack, you know. No, I found, you know, through the years that most of the guys are pretty understandable about it, you know. Yeah, I had a few instances like that. Like, somebody woke up and asked me for an autograph, take a swing at me. But they realized that I fought back. And I didn't have any trouble like that from the time I got out of the service on. Just those first few years, it was, I had to watch for it, you know. That's exactly what they did, you know. And we were under wartime conditions in Germany, and I was in a tank corps, so. We were up on the Russian zone most of the time, just on patrol. And the weather was bad. It was 10 degrees below zero. And I tried to keep my morale up and keep going, keep busy. I was pleased with it. Yeah. The first few days, the guys just watched me. Kind of watched me to see what I was doing, what I was going to do. When they saw I was doing the same thing that they were, they started to come around and talk to me and ask me questions about what was it like to make a movie, stuff like that. I found myself in Germany. Guys would get letters from home. The girl had gone with another guy. They'd come wake me up in the middle of the night. Asked me about it. Asked me to read the letter. I found myself advising these guys what to do. I had a girlfriend too that was ding-a-ling, man, running off with somebody else. But I didn't say anything about my own situation. I just kept it quiet. I had four movies: Love Me Tonight, Loving You, Jailhouse Rock, and King Creole. Well, by that time, I wasn't thinking along those lines. I didn't associate myself as being that. I was busy with a script. I had to memorize a script. It changed a lot of those things. It was work. It was a job, you know. I had to be there at a certain time in the morning and work a certain amount of hours, and that's exactly how I treated it. So I was more concerned about if the picture's any good or if I was any good. And I cared so much until I became physically ill. I would become violently ill. I'd get a temperature or something would happen to me. The fact that I didn't, at a certain stage, I had no say-so in it. I didn't have final approval of the script, which means that I couldn't say this is not good for me. Or it was that type, it was more or less that type of thing. I don't think anybody was consciously trying to harm me. It was just Hollywood's image of me was wrong, and I knew it, and I couldn't say anything about it. I couldn't do anything about it. I'd be writing to production. I was doing a lot of pictures close together, and the pictures got very similar. A lot of them got very similar, and they, you know, if something was successful, I'd try to recreate it the next time around. So I'd read the first 4 or 5 pages, and I knew that it was just a different name with 12 new songs, and the songs were mediocre in most cases. You can't get a song. So that's what might have made it seem like the indifference, you know. But I was never indifferent. I was so concerned until that's all I talked about. It worried me sick, you know. So I had to change it, which I did, you know. I had to change it around. I was obligated in like 4 years in advance. You know. It's nobody's fault, maybe except my own. I didn't know what to do. I just felt I was obligated very heavily to, a lot of times, to things that I didn't fully believe in. And that was very difficult. You know. I mean, the contracts were signed like 4 years in advance.
11 pictures, 7 pictures, no matter what pictures.
So I had thought that they would try to get a new property for me or give me a chance to show some kind of acting ability or do a very interesting story. But it did not change. It did not change. And so I became very discouraged. They couldn't have paid me no amount of money in the world to make me feel any self-satisfaction inside. I literally took it as long as I could. You know, physically, emotionally, everything. Not all the movies were that bad. In between, I would do something that was entertaining to people, just to a pure entertainment nature. So, like Tickle Me or something like that, I would do. Mm-hmm. They worked well on television, you know. But it got to be a thing also of 10 to 12 songs in a movie. It was very difficult to get good material. And I know good material when I hear it. See. Songs had to fit situations. And I had to gear down to that particular thing, like sing to a dog.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.